CNBC-TV18 special discussion. We're discussing the potential of creating a renewable energy movement in this country. The Prime Minister's stated objective, and I'm going to quote some pretty big numbers to you, is a 15% renewable energy generation target by 2020. The government is aiming to add about 100,000 megawatts over the next 5 years, which gives an investment opportunity of at least $100 billion. And to put all of this into perspective, I have with me an esteemed panel. Joining us today is Upendra Tripathi, the Secretary of the Ministry for New and Renewable Energy. Also with us, Mr. K.S. Popri, the Chairman and Managing Director of the IREDA. With us, Suman Sinha and Ajay Goel of Tata Solar. Gentlemen, appreciate you joining us. As I pointed out at the start, Mr. Tripathi, ambitious targets that the government has set for itself. I know you're trying to attract big ticket investments, and which is the purpose of conducting the reinvestment summit here in India. How much do you really hope to sign up as far as reinvest is concerned?
You know, 100,000, in fact, everybody is saying it's very ambitious, but as you know, the Prime Minister thinks in terms of things being bold, big and beautiful. Mm-hmm. So 100,000, given our potential of 7.5 gigawatt in the country, solar particularly, it's not really that ambitious in the sense that it will not be possible to be done. Mm-hmm. And we have put a proper plan in place as to how it can be translated into action over the next 5 years or 7 years.
So can you give us the specifics of what is phase one and what can we expect, for instance, over the next 12 months, the next 24 months, and eventually in the next 5 years?
In fact, that is the one that is being worked out. We have hired a professional agency and they have given a breakup, a tentative breakup. 40,000 megawatt will be towards rooftop and rest all will be in the solar parks and all that. But mm-hmm. it has to formally go to the cabinet. And we also plan to bring quite a few new schemes along with it. For example, we feel that the unemployed graduates mm-hmm. in the country, so 20,000 of them, we will identify unemployed commerce graduates or engineers, and who can go in a mini scale, can be also solar entrepreneurs.
Okay.
And all the existing power stations in various states where the connectivity cost from the solar generation mm. point will be minimal. Mm. That way we will achieve 20,000 megawatt in all states put together. We are also working out a scheme apart from the rooftop, taking up in a major way of the solar parks, the 25 new solar parks which have come up in the sense it has been approved. 16 have been in principle approval have been given. We have already released some 200 crores to the states towards this purpose, and we presume that 20 to 30,000 megawatt will come in the solar parks. The real challenge is number one, the evacuation. Mm. You know, how do you take from one place to the other, and the cost of evacuation. And the second is, of course, the making the discoms. You know, happily buy this power because yeah. it's still relatively little costlier.
That's right.
And that's why the mechanism.
And given the state of affairs as far as state utility boards are concerned or discoms are concerned, that is going to be a significant challenge for you to be able to address. How are you going to address that?
In fact, two ways. We are trying to get it over. One is, of course, incentivizing them to buy this, and also, the making it statutorily obligatory on their part to buy it.
I was going to ask you exactly about that. You have that obligation, but then it's a chicken and egg situation because they're already in such a dire situation that if you actually make it mandatory for them and you impose obligations on them, the question then is how are they going to be able to deal with it?
That is where the question of comes, what my minister has been telling you, the innovative financing. Innovative financing basically means you reduce the cost of power, make it play in the market on its own, which means bring in grid parity. Now, professional agencies say that in some states, grid parity is very close because where the cost of coal or thermal is very high, that the solar is relatively cheaper. But in next 2-3 years, we expect that solar power will be equally costly compared to coal and other forms of energy. In that case, in fact, I feel after 3-4 years, the DISCOMs will buy more of solar to reduce the cost of traditional power.
So let's address each of these issues. And so once again, let me ask you now, because as I pointed out, it's an ambitious plan. It's a plan that will work well for India in the long term as far as our energy security vision is concerned. But what would you like the government to do? The budget is around the corner, and obviously the sector is expecting sweetness from the finance minister. If I could ask you specifically, what is it more that you would like to see being put on the table as far as incentives are concerned?
The key for us really is the point that Secretary Tripathi made, which is that we have to get the cost of the power to come down. And that is what is going to make it attractive for the distribution companies to buy it. And given the cash-strapped situation, it'll also make it easier for them to
buy. So how do you achieve green
parity? So how do you achieve that? See, there are couple of very sort of simple things that can be done. Number one is on the tax side, and the number two is on the financing side.
Yeah.
On the tax side, for example, today we are subject to paying MAT as a IPP, right? There is an accelerated depreciation benefit for certain types of companies. If that can be extended to IPPs as well, because IPPs ultimately add the bulk of the capacity. So if they can extend some sort of a MAT rebate to us, that would, I think, be very fundamental.
I know that a differential MAT rate is being mulled at this point in time. Whether you're going to be a beneficiary or not, I don't know. And whether it eventually is rolled out in the budget, we don't know.
But I think that's very important. That, in some senses, levels the playing field for us in the sector, also brings our costs down.
On Mr. Tripathi, have you made that recommendation to the finance minister, by the way?
We don't discuss budget issues, remember? But we always encourage our industry to articulate their points of view to the finance minister.
Okay, you've given us an indication then. Yes, sir.
And the second thing is on the financing side. For example, can there be some sort of interest subvention that is given to us, especially for people who are not claiming accelerated depreciation benefits? Give us an interest subvention of even 2 or 3% compared to the normal cost. That will bring down the cost of power by almost 70 to 80 paise.
Low-cost financing, low-cost debt financing, interest subventions, Mr. Popley, what can we expect?
Well, we have already shifted to long-term financing that will bring down the initial tariff that they need to pay to the utilities. Then we are also getting funding from bilateral, multilateral agencies. There the cost of hedging is a concern, and we are working out a modality where the cost of hedging can be reduced. We had some discussions earlier, and if we can peg it to 4%, probably the cost of funding can be reduced by another 1-2%, and that will definitely help the industry and the sector.
Let me add one more thing to the financing piece, right, that both Samantha and Mr. Popley referred to, which is, you know, look, there's a lot of cheap capital available for renewable projects in the world, but it's hesitant to invest in India because of the currency risk. So one of the crazy ideas that has been suggested is, can we give these PPAs in US dollars instead of rupees? And that way the government takes on more of the currency risk rather than passing it on to investors. So maybe the global, you know, investor meet, that's something that people would ask for. We are willing to sign, you know, PPA as long as you do it in US dollars, something to think
and
about.
And this has been something that has come up in the past as well, the currency fluctuation and the currency fluctuation related risk.
I can add that apart from the hedging risk, you know, which is very costly, 7-8% now, many foreign companies also like to raise rupee bonds in India. You know, and they are working on that. Plus, for example, agencies like IRIDA, who have recommended that they should be permitted to raise either tax-paid or tax-free, you know, solar bonds. Because in the domestic market, there's quite a bit of potential that can be exploited towards solar purpose. So they have to come up with a list of, you know, a number of innovative funding or financing mechanisms where the cost of capital may not be brought down to 5-6% as elsewhere, but at least it can be substantially reduced to 8-9% from existing 12-13%.
Okay.
I think there has to be some mechanism set up to strengthen the grid within the country that will really take. And I know the ministry started to work on a green corridor. But more than the ministry, I think they have to set up the right incentive mechanisms for private parties to actually invest in the grid. Otherwise, we will not see much growth that is happening.
Status as far as the green corridor is concerned, because we've been getting all kinds of reports on where things currently stand. If you can give us an update on where things stand for the green corridor.
Now, the green energy corridor in the phase one, it is different phases. In the phase one, 8 states have been actively involved. Tamil Nadu has made considerable progress. Other states, they're also availing 1 billion euros loan from the KfW. And but more importantly, for phase two, we are now working. You know, what essentially we're asking in phase two is that the state should give us for next 3 years, which are the locations where these renewable energy projects are going to come up. So that the green energy corridor, the phase two, can be located there.
Is this target going to be achievable? I'm talking about the big target that you held out. Is it going to be achievable without getting the states on board?
Without states cooperation and help and leadership, it will be difficult to do it, because that land belongs to them. They are the ones who will find out land. In fact, although we found the Westland Development Board has given us statistics, plenty of land is available in Westland form. Plus, we have the highways, the sites of the highways 50 meters can be exploited. Mm. We have the canal bonds, canal roofs, canal banks, and rooftops. For example, 1.38 gigawatt is the potential of rooftops in India alone. So for 100,000 megawatt, we do not find land to pose such a, you know, insurmountable danger for us. Evacuation, we have to look at that, because that is the crucial thing, and the cost imposed by the states. That is why we have, you know, a variety of consultation processes with the states, and they are actively involved. In fact, now they have committed, you know, to take this movement forward.
Okay. Sumant, one of the other challenges, and of course it ties in with the government's whole mission of Make in India and so on and so forth, promoting domestic manufacturing when you can actually get much, much cheaper imports from China, which is perhaps why the government has not imposed an anti-dumping duty on imports coming in from China, because of the state of the domestic industry and capacity that we are producing domestically. What will need to be done to be able to address those challenges going forward as we try and achieve this target?
No, so I totally agree with you. I think this Make in India campaign and manufacturing, let's say, solar panels in India, I think is absolutely critical. Because if you're going to do 100,000 megawatts, that's going to involve almost $50, $60 billion of imports over the next 5-7 years. That's a humongous thing. I think, you know, wind turbines are almost entirely manufactured in India. All the supply chain is also localized. I don't see any reason why we can't get to that same competitiveness in solar panel manufacturing as well. That does mean the creation of an ecosystem. We don't have any back end, let's say, silicon onwards. We have mostly cells and wafers. So we have to think about how we can backward integrate. But I think the government is in a little bit of a difficult position, because they have to give some visibility of capacity to domestic manufacturing, which is unfortunately at a higher cost. So it's a bit of a bind. And I know the government is trying its best to thread the needle by giving some unspoken sort of commitments, or unwritten commitments rather. Of course, they have to be spoken.
Yeah.
So they are unwritten commitments. So having said that, I can see that a lot of potential investors are looking at the space. Chinese companies are thinking about manufacturing in India, because they can also use India as a manufacturing base for exporting into the US and Europe, which is not possible.
Will the obligatory route work here as well, Mr. Tripathi?
Well, I must tell you that the RE Invest 2015 is one way to strengthen the manufacturing sector also in India. And of the solar parks we have created, 25, we have some manufacturing parks, which means any manufacturer who comes forward to manufacture in India, they will also have a facility to develop on their own.
What is the feedback that you're actually getting in terms of being able to set up manufacturing in India?
In fact, as Suman said, we have got a number of companies from outside who would like to tie up with Indian companies, Indian manufacturers, and strengthen production as a whole. And it is not only for that tremendous Indian market that they can exploit, also India as a center from where they can export outside.
What kind of commitments are you giving to them?
Well, one thing is that in the solar parks, we will have manufacturing sections. So any manufacturer who comes, we will give them all encouragement, we will handhold them. And the manufacturing sector is a crucial thing for 100,000 megawatt to take place. Plus, we have said that the existing manufacturers will be given all support in terms of strengthening their production, damping of production. Because without domestic production, it will be very difficult to sustain a movement.
Ajay Goel, the intent is clear. This government is serious about getting this movement off the ground. But from a private sector participation point of view, and a lot of the installed capacity that we actually have today, which accounts for about 13% of the energy mix, is on account of the effort of the government and the private sector as well. As we move from 13% to 15% by 2020, what is it that the private sector would want to see more from the government? And also, what kind of collaborations would you like to see? Because if reinvest is all about collaborating with whether it's multilateral agencies or private sector, foreign companies, what is it that India's private sector is looking for?
So I think India's manufacturing sector in solar has been severely battered over the last 4 or 5 years, right? They invested a lot of money, you know, 4 or 5 years ago when the National Solar Mission was being launched, and have since then suffered gravely because of cheap imports, right? So now, you know, we're very happy that the new government has come in and said we'll support manufacturing, we'll do a variety of policies. But until the health of these companies improves and their bottom lines start to get healthy, I don't think you will see enough influx as yet. So I think it will take probably a little bit more time for outside manufacturers to come and invest. And even the current guys, they would want to see a consistent demand that is coming in from the Indian side. Now, when it comes to disparity in cost structure, I think the disparity in cost structure is also driven by the fact that the cost of capital and the cost of labor in India is much higher than countries like China. Right? So the consistency of demand, I think, and the focus on manufacturing and job creation is something that the government has to actually walk the talk before you will see significant investment.
Government is confident of being able to meet these targets. What's your own sense as part of industry of being able to achieve all of this?
I think the government has to put a little bit of money where its mouth is. They have to really start to deliver on some of these promises and fund them. Because I think one of the challenges that the government has inherited, right, is limited amount of funds
and
failed to deliver on promises.
So let's get the secretary to address those. And these are legitimate, genuine concerns. What can we actually expect as far as, government is concerned? And the finance minister continues to say that he's fiscally constrained and his hands are tied. So, you know, what can we really expect in terms of your own investment?
So far as financial problem is concerned, it's a common global problem. Every government is, you know, resource constrained. So within that, we have done well because this year our budget has gone up by 65%. You know, earlier we had 1,600 crores and the present Prime Minister made it 2,500 crores, brought in series of new proposals. The solar parks was a new proposal.
We're talking about 2,500 crores, you're talking about $100 billion, let's get real.
Real, yes, and that part is, you know, see, $100 billion is over 5 years,
okay?
And we have $6 billion investment now. It's a question of additional $14 billion.
But you
and
need
that
to go,
$14 billion,
you need
that
to go
is
from,
why...
You need to go from $6 billion to $20 billion. So you need to go from 36,000 crores to 120,000 crores.
That is why
crores.
The reinvest has come. Yeah. And it is going to be an annual feature. And this reinvestment, already we have got commitment for 20,000 megawatt. You know, from the private sector, very reliable commitment figures which they are going to present to the Honorable Prime Minister on the date, you know, they give.
So committed for 20,000 megawatt.
Committed for 20,000 megawatt. This year and next year again RE Invest will get again commitment for 20,000 megawatt. And
someone said, you know, it sounds too good to be true. You've got committed funding of $20 billion already. Industry is extremely committed to being able to work with the government to make this vision a reality and so on and so forth. What are we missing here?
I think number one is execution in India at the ground level is not that easy. Getting land, you know, whether it's revenue land or forest land or private land, and then executing there, you know, just doing 150 megawatt project can take you like a year just because of the problems around land, right? And those problems are not going away, at least now, right?
Yeah.
And I think right now it's great that the government is creating all of this buzz and excitement. Because
but
that
the evidence of that has not translated to the ground.
But hopefully it will start translating. My concern is if at that point in time, or by that point in time, the states have not fully come on board, or at the local level, the issues have not sort of got fully resolved, you'll find a lot of foreign investors will then begin to get unhappy, disappointed, and then, you know, they'll say, oh my God, it's the same thing, it's the old India story, a lot of excitement, no real action. And that is what concerns me, that, you know, a year down the road, we should not get to that point.
Okay, Mr. Popli, innovative financing products, innovative financing options, what more can we expect? What is going to be the priority for you?
We would like to reduce the cost of funding that we do to private sector, and already, I mean, the pressure for interest rate is to come down. The cost of hedging will come down. We will be increasing the tenure of loans. And I think these three, four things should help. And of course, there are other innovative products, like if you have tax-free bond, tax-paid bonds also, we have green bonds. All these things are going to help.
Mr. Tripathi, since you've been firing from the shoulder of industry, let me ask you, has industry made a representation to the government with things like tax-free bonds? Are we likely to see this being on the agenda as far as the finance minister is concerned?
Let me add one or two points to the financing side. We are actively involved with the World Bank, with the ADB at all levels to see that maximum flow of funds comes to the renewable energy sector. Even at bilateral level, whether it is Japan or with USA, the USA Exim Bank just, you know, signed an MOU with IRIDA with $1 billion, you know, open funds, in the sense anybody who would import things from USA, they will be able to get that loan at a cheaper rate. Number two, we are also thinking of $500 million from the foreign exchange reserve that can be placed at the, you know, disposal of IFCL. Who could also lend it to the private sector. This year. So we have put a variety of things together. My minister had a meeting with all the bank heads. We are saying that a particular funds from the credit exposure of the banks can be earmarked for renewable energy sector. And that will open a channel of funding. Plus, recently the RBI has said that the tenure of loan can be 80% of the time of the project life.
Right.
In this case, if the PPA is for 25 years, which means that 20 years can be the project life.
Mm.
Now, once your project life goes up, your cost will come down.
Right.
So it's not merely the credit availability, but you're putting all things together so that the cost of the project comes down. Now, your second question, see, in a democracy, whether the government is always open to suggestions. You get from press, you get from your channels like this, and they're very open to the suggestions, and they themselves, government realizes that renewable energy is in the interest of the nation.
Well, since the Prime Minister has put his might behind renewable energy and the growth of renewable energy in this country, hopefully we will see a lot of this the stuff that we've talked about here on this panel today being translated into reality, and maybe you will get a special dispensation from the Finance Minister in Budget 2015 as well. As I said, we don't know, but it sounds like you've made a logical case for your sector, sir. And we do hope that you are able to achieve the objectives, and we do hope that we will, when we next meet, be talking about higher targets and higher commitments as far as investments are concerned. But thank you very much for joining us here on CNBC-TV18 with your thoughts on what we should expect for the renewable energy sector going forward. With that, it's time for us to wrap up this special show. We'll see you again next week. Till then, all of us here, goodbye. Many thanks for watching.